back. Joe here, Psychedelics Today. Really appreciate you tuning in again. Today on the show, we have Sheree Malcolm Gadasi, the psychedelic integration coach. We got to meet up with her at the recent Psychedelic Science Conference and had a great time. Great person. We have an awesome conversation here discussing everything from integration, providing integration services, holotropic breathwork, how powerful that can be. And I think we get into, you know, what happens when maybe people do too much psychedelics, and how to get back in your body, how to feel normal again, because sometimes it can be really an alienating experience, especially when repeated and repeated too often. We really hope you enjoy it. It was super fun talking to Sheree, and I think we're going to get an interview with Sheree for our psychedelic self-care and integration course, so that should be really cool. Enrollment for that psychedelic self-care and integration course will wrap up pretty soon. I think we're going to cut off sales this Friday, maybe. So if you want to get it at the $50 price that we have it up there for, better jump on it. The next round will be a little more money, but it'll be a lot more valuable. Check that out. If you have any questions, let us know. You know how to reach us through our Facebook group or website. Also, email psychedelicstoday@gmail.com. It is festival season, so it is time to get educated on how to be safe with these substances, how to tell others, you know, what the best practices are, how not to get hurt or sick. There is some recent articles out there on fentanyl being in cocaine. So 20 people at a party ODing somewhere from using cocaine for the very opposite reaction. I don't know if anybody died, but that's pretty bad. We just posted an article the other day about a lot of drug users being tested positive for fentanyl without ever having knowingly used it. It was laced in the drugs they were using and came out in the drug panel tests in their urine. So we're not saying drug testing kits are going to get that. I think you need a mass spectrometer to rule out fentanyl, but you can rule out a lot of other things like 2,5-IN bomb or other various chemicals that don't have a long and proven safety record that you want to conform to. So go to Dance Safe and pick up a test kit. I think that's really a good idea. Announcements. Kyle and I will be in the Northeast in early June, hanging out with the Boston Entheogenic Network. I think I'm going to do a talk on Sunday in Boston and maybe Lowell, Massachusetts. Kyle, I think, is doing some breath work and maybe some drumming, shamanic drumming kind of stuff. And that should be really neat. Also, I have a bunch of breathwork workshops coming up. Really excited about this weekend's workshop. Still some spots left if you want to come. It's in Breckenridge, Colorado, May 21. It's a full-day workshop out here. So that should be pretty awesome. Also have a few others. There's a June 4, July 8, and August 6 workshop in Breckenridge. I've also got a really cool three-day it's Friday, Saturday, Sunday. So yeah, I guess that's 3 days. Workshop in Lyons, Colorado, a little north of Boulder. And it's up on a nice ranch. And I think it's going to last about we'll do breathwork 1 day and my form. So dream shadow, transpersonal breathwork. We'll also do some rebirthing style breathwork. What are we calling it? Conscious breath work. And also a lady called Gunjasana, who does some really interesting yoga and marijuana work and also some kind of ecological advocacy along with that. Should be really cool. We're doing some sound healing and a fire ceremony. I'm not sure what that means yet, but I'm sure I'll find out when I'm there. And I think we're providing all the food, and I'm going to be camping, which is really cool. Really excited about that. So that's really it for announcements on my end. I think Kyle will be hanging out in Vermont for the next month, cruising all over, interviewing folks, and doing some breath work at the Gibsons at Dream Shadow. Check those workshops out at dreamshadow.com. That's enough for now. If you haven't heard about transpersonal breath work, you really owe it to yourself. It's a slightly rebranded version of holotropic breath work. It's the same format. We've got loads of experience working with people, and we are students of Stan Grof for sure. So, almost forgot. If you get this in the next few days, we're doing a 10-book giveaway plus a DVD and a seat to our psychedelic self-care and integration course, the full one that's coming up that we'll announce soon. The books are a whole bunch of Groff books. We're giving away PCAL by Ann and Sasha Shulgin, Psychedelic Explorer's Guide by Fadiman, LSD My Problem Child by Albert Hoffman, and a signed copy of The Brotherhood of the Screaming Abyss, My Life with Terrence McKenna by his brother Dennis McKenna. Really cool book, signed copy. To enter, visit our website, and there's a link at the top. It says Psychedelic Ultimate Psychedelic Book Giveaway. Click that. You can put in your email, share it with your friends to get more chances to win. You can share it all over social too to get more people to subscribe. And we really appreciate it. We really appreciate you guys loving us, and we're loving how many people we have on Facebook now. I think we're up to like 1,300. I just really appreciate you guys checking us out and supporting us. If you do want to support us, join this contest. Or if you don't want to, maybe leave us a review on iTunes. Again, thank you all for tuning in, and see you on the next episode. Bye.
Welcome to Psychedelics Today with your hosts, Kyle and Joe. Today we're here with Sheree Malcolm Gadasi. Sheree and I met from some of the MAPS calls that we were having about integration. And then we also just met up at the MAPS conference and had a nice integration lunch. And so it's great to have you on and talk about what you're doing. You're also known as a psychedelic integration coach, correct?
Yes. Hi. Thank you so much for having me. This is awesome.
Yeah. Cool. So, let's chat just briefly about the conference. Was anything stand out for you while you were there?
The last MAPS conference, absolutely. Yeah. So I was fortunate enough to be able to sign up for the entire conference, including the pre and post offerings that they had. And I had been having a dream throughout my academic life, which is very long lived, about a year and a half, of meeting Stan Grof, which is one of my idols, because I'm very much into transpersonal and spiritual psychology. And he provided a 2-day holotropic breathwork shop. And my biggest takeaway from the entire conference, even though it was 6 days long for me, was having a chance to sit with him as he was literally on his hands and knees when I was doing my holotropic breathing. And I remember him looking at me and staring at me with such compassion in his eyes. And it felt as if I was the only person in the world, and the things he was talking to me about felt like it was the last conversation he will ever have. So just having that beautiful connection with his entire focus and energy on me really reminded me of what medicine is. And why we're doing this work, that the real medicine is all about human connection and supporting one another. Mm. And that was a very profound and beautiful experience for me that I'm really still trying to cultivate and integrate every day in my everyday relationship. So I really loved that reminder by this great, great man.
The real medicine is about human connection. You posted something about that the other day. Was it the ultimate psychedelic is other people? The ultimate
treasure. Yes, human. Like, yes. Oh,
goodness gracious, what a beautiful thing.
Why do we forget that? You know, why do we?
Yep, it's fascinating.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Were you able to jump in on any talks, or were you kind of, I know I was kind of fried just chatting with everybody, and I was volunteering, so I didn't get to see too much, but was there any talk that stood out for you there?
Yeah, I try to run around to as many talks as possible, which I think in hindsight was a mistake a little bit, because a lot of the big idea behind conventions is the networking, and again, meeting and connecting, which I've definitely had a lot of that as well, thankfully. But one talk that particularly stood out for me, well, a few of them. Mark Ashala, I think his last name is, from ICERS, which gave a talk about integration, as well as the one-day integration workshop, of course, that they had at the end. I found it extremely useful to work with other integration specialists in the field. Tanya Mate, Julie Mengler from Erie, and the guys over at the New York Institute. And I loved learning from these different professionals because they each bring a different type of experience to the field and different academic backgrounds and accreditation. So I thought it was really neat to see how each and every one of these professionals work. And I definitely learned a lot. So I think my favorite part was actually the integration workshop, if anything. Yeah, I took a lot out of that and was able to implement a lot of the techniques with my clients already. So that was great.
Awesome. Cool.
That's fascinating how quickly you could actually adapt that stuff, because that was only a handful of weeks ago. That's great. I have not talked to Tanya Mate, but she seems really interesting in that she's doing a lot of ayahuasca work currently, because obviously your father, Gabor Mate, is really interesting, but he can't do...
Father-in-law.
I did not know that. That's good to know. Thank you for clarifying. Mm-hmm. He can't really do too much ayahuasca work because the Canadian government threatened his licensure or something. So it's cool the daughter can. And I think she's probably, quite brilliant, even though I haven't really heard anything about her. But can you tell us, was there anything in particular in the integration seminar that was gold for you?
Sure. Well, if you want to talk about Tanya specifically, I would love to. I don't know her too well, although I definitely have an intention.
It's okay.
One of my biggest learnings from the workshop was actually by Tanya, which, yes, she does ayahuasca integration. She's one of the only ones that I'm at least aware of in our field that particularly works with the medicine. Mm-hmm. And since this is something that I try to offer as well, one of my services as a psychedelic integration coach is I do offer ayahuasca preparation and integration services. I personally have been working with this mother plant only for a couple of years, so I'm very new to the field, but to working with this medicine. But I remember from the first time that I drank, my life has just changed in so many ways that I just knew that this is something that was very needed, and I really wanted to be able to offer it even as a peer to others that are undergoing all these circles and experiences. So here in Los Angeles, we, obviously ayahuasca can be drank across the jungle, you fly out of the US and engage in all these ceremonies, but the reality is that many individuals drink here in the United States, especially in LA, where a lot of circles take place. So many people in our community that undergo profound experiences with this medicine and don't have anyone to speak with. So what I loved learning from Tanya at the workshop, Tanya works at the Temple of the Way of Light, which is in Peru, and she is the integration specialist there. And she takes a lot after her father-in-law, Gabor, which his entire philosophy, as far as I understand it, is working around childhood trauma, early developmental childhood trauma, and really understanding that the medicines bring up, especially ayahuasca, bring up a lot of those core issues from our youth that need to be dealt with. So it's all about feelings. So, if someone, for example, has a, comes out of an ayahuasca experience with completely incoherent, has an ineffable experience that is difficult to put into words, it feels like they're all over the place. The idea behind it, the integration, is to really try and see how they feel about it or what feelings came up, and even how they're feeling at the moment while they're trying to explain this ceremony to you, and take it from there. Like, what core feelings come up? Mm. Yeah. And the core feelings that Tanya specifically mentioned is the core feelings that we work around are joy, pain, anger, shame, guilt, and one more. I think maybe one more that I'm forgetting. But basically everything boils down to one of these core feelings that haven't been resolved in our youth that need resolution and healing now.
Hmm.
Yeah.
It's really interesting. When you're talking about that, it makes me think about some of the gruff, the coex themes, and those breathwork realms. You might just have this common feeling or theme of feeling shame, or anger, and it has all these roots in different places. So that's interesting.
Right. And, you know, it's just amazing how, you know, as children, everyone, all of us come into this world with an ability to feel, obviously. That's what our life experience or our human condition is about. It's about feelings. Now, energy that passes through our body manifests through us as feelings. And if we don't allow ourselves to feel, then the energy gets trapped in our body and then becomes trauma that's trapped in our body. So I know that you guys are really into transformational breath work, and the idea is to get the oxygen flowing through your body to move through all those areas in the body that are stuck and have those feelings trapped in there. So really move them through and get them out. Isn't that right?
The Groff quote we like, I think Kyle likes it too, is the full expression of any emotion is the funeral pyre of that thing. So if you can fully express that thing, that thing is resolved semi-permanently, at least, you know, if not fully. And it's kind of true. It's kind of like Ramdas saying, like, you know, you can't necessarily get rid of these neuroses permanently, but you can get into a much better relationship to them, a lot less pain as a result. So right. I like identify with both ways. I don't. Does that kind of make sense?
Yeah, definitely.
Cool.
Yeah, and I think about that Groff quote. It's like, you know, we might keep emotions inside, and to fully like experience that, maybe in a breathwork session, like just fully experiencing some of that anger and letting it out, you know, it can be transformative, because maybe you've never felt that. You just kind of bottled it up. And I remember this psychiatrist once said, it's like, I don't get angry, I grow tumors. So,
oh,
you know,
my goodness. Oh.
You know, because like we keep everything inside. And so to be able to express that negative emotion fully can help get it out. You know?
Exactly. It's all about expression and permission, to be given the permission to express.
Yeah.
And ayahuasca works in that way, that she forces you to express it. She forces you to feel it. And integration specifically, which is what I'm trying to support people with, is about giving people permission to talk about their experience, to witness their experience, to bring up whatever came up without having to be coherent or make sense of anything. Just give them the space to feel and to be and to be heard. Mm. And that's really the idea behind being an integration coach, which is why we're speaking. So.
Yeah. Awesome. Let's jump back a little bit and let's talk about how you got into this. I know you have a master's degree and your concentration was in psychedelic integration therapy. So I'm kind of curious how you got involved and how did you end up concentrating in psychedelic integration? That's really cool.
Yeah. Thanks for asking that. So the way that I got into the psychedelic field to begin with was, I don't like to use the word accident because nothing is an accident, but it was definitely not something that I ever planned. I originally in my undergrad studied creative education. I was a teacher and I was also a marketing director for a cosmetics company for a while. And a few years ago, when I just moved back to the U.S. after a while of living in Israel, which is where I was born, I lived there for a few years and decided to come back. This is where my family lives, and here in LA, and was kind of looking for my community and my crew and new people to hang out with. And I really got into the transformational festival scene and started very sporadically, although always mindfully, very sporadically experimenting with substances. And until one time that I was at a festival and a friend provided me with a little sack of what I think was MDMA and said, okay, you can use some of it, don't use all of it. And then sure enough, the entire packet poured into my drink.
Oh, jeez.
And I was like, okay, water here is really expensive. I really want to drink this water. So I ended up drinking the entire bottle. And lo and behold, I ended up having probably the most transformational event of my life. Which was absolutely beautiful, but again, I was very new to psychedelic use to begin with, so it was really mind-boggling. I had no idea how to wrap my head around it, And then the months that came later, everything started changing pretty rapidly in my life. A series of events that, again, everything was, I believe, was completely planned. One of these events was a traumatic breakup that I had, and without any previous spiritual background or any spiritual practices, I was just in such a low place that I felt like I needed to do something to make me feel better. And I just started meditating out of the blue and started meditating. And within a couple of times that I did that, I started doing breath work while I was meditating. And then all of a sudden I had an incredible transformation. What I now understand was a holotropic state of consciousness that, when I woke up from that, I woke up like a new person, literally. Everything that I knew about my past was done. And I woke up a new person that just knew with all of her heart and being and soul that I have to support people who do psychedelics. You know, even telling the story sounds sometimes so crazy to me, but, you know, that was the reality for me. And immediately everything in my life, again, just kept changing. I immediately signed up for grad school to study psychology. I knew I wanted to be a psychedelic psychotherapist. And just started meeting all the right people at the right time, started volunteering in the community, went to a conference, which was here in LA last year, called Visionary Convergence, which is where I met my husband also. So it was that life-changing. And at Visionary Convergence, there were a few speakers that completely blew my mind. One of them was Julie Megler from Erie, who spoke about the concept of integration. The other one, also from the Bay Area, Susana Bustos, who also talks and works with integration. And just sitting there and trying to figure out, I was still, again, very new in the world of psychedelics and trying to figure out, okay, what do I want to contribute in this world? Psychedelic therapy will be legal in a few years, thank God. MDMA is about to be legal, but it's still not. So what can I do in the meantime? And integration really spoke to me because it felt like there is so much use, but people are not really, perhaps are not aware that there's a lot of work to be done with them, with these substances, to use them for psycho-spiritual growth and well-being. And basically that we have a gap in our medical system the medical system does not, plainly and clearly, does not support individuals who use psychedelics, even though millions and millions of people use them every year. So listening to Susanna and Julie, I just, you know, understood that what they're doing is absolutely incredible. I'm totally inspired, and this is what I need to do. And simultaneously, my friend Ashley, who is also another lioness in the field of psychedelics here in LA, we decided to join forces and co-founded the first integration organization here in Los Angeles called Inner Space Integration, and started running community circles and took it from there. And simultaneously, while I was in grad school, so I was really lucky, and this is perhaps something that we might want to talk about, because I do get asked about this so often. Where did you study what you do? Where did you study psychedelics? What school teaches psychedelics? Send me there. And again, I do want to emphasize that our huge need to surrender to just what happens in our lives and just say yes. And again, everything that's happened to me has brought me to where I am. And my going to grad school on that string of events of just like things that started happening to me, I was looking for a school where I could go back to school, study, get my master's in psychology as soon as possible. And I found a school in LA called Antioch University, which at the time, little did I know, they were a super liberal social justice type of school. And they had a program called Master's in Psychology, Individualized Concentration, which basically you can pick out a theme or a topic to your, you know, a field to your heart's desire, and you supplement the regular master's in psych with independent study and research and in the field that you wish to specialize in. And so that's what I did. I I, again, by chance, quote unquote, met someone who was who's now the head of Crossroads Ibogaine Clinic in Mexico, Dr. Joseph Barzuglia, the amazing Dr. Joseph Barzuglia, who at the time was a clinical research director, and I started assisting him on various research that he was working on. And so I did that, and then we opened Inner Space, and I also did I got a coaching certificate through Being True to You, which I can't recommend enough. This program is mainly focused on addiction recovery, but they also do psycho-spiritual integration because they primarily cater to individuals who have addicts who use ibogaine therapy to recover. So they offer to them psychedelic integration. So I studied with Deanne, which now I work with as well. And that was an incredible supplement to my knowledge because, you know, when I was trying to make my way and really root down in my master's degree and really, you know, trying to make it as legit as possible, you know, there isn't, integration is such a new field that there isn't a lot of material on it at all. Not a lot, not books, no papers, nothing. So when I wrote my master's on psychedelic integration therapy, I felt like I had a huge responsibility to really back up the idea of integration with, you know, as much psychology theory as I possibly could find that I felt related to it. So I backed it up a lot with Jungian theory, which I'm very connected to, with transpersonal psychology, obviously, Stan Grof, existential psychology, learned from Claudio Naranjo, and really just trying to do, I just did, you know, did a lot of legwork and to prove, quote unquote, what the academics want is, you know, everything is proof. So I wrote an excellent paper that I'm super proud of, and I was legit.
Awesome.
So that's how I got my master's in psychology. Yeah. And yeah.
Who is Claudio?
That's how I got into school. Claudio Naranjo, actually, he also spoke at the conference. He gave a couple of talks, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, he was.
Another elder in the field. Yeah.
Chilean psychiatrist, right? And he's...
Oh, he's the guy you wanted to talk to, Kyle. We spoke about him a few times.
Oh. Yeah.
I did not catch any of his stuff on stage, unfortunately. Thankfully, I hope it's on YouTube.
Yeah, I think it... I hope so too. Yeah, that's really great. And I think a lot of people don't always take advantage of the individualized or independent studies in their programs. And I think that's a really great way to go about studying some of this stuff. Because even in my undergrad, I did a lot of this. And my undergrad school was very liberal, but also had a lot of independent studies. So I remember in 2013, I made an independent study to go out to the MAPS conference and wrote a bunch of papers and did a summary. And so, yeah, that's really awesome. Was your program clinical? So did it lead towards licensure or?
So thanks so much for asking, because this is a topic that has been, has taken up a lot of my energy in the last year. So originally, when I decided to go back to school, my intention was to get my master's and then go and get my license through a PhD clinical psych. So to get licensed through my doctorate degree. And so I did not do my master's is not clinical because, again, I wanted to get my hours later. Mm-hmm. And then what ended up happening by virtue of again, just a lot of lessons in self-growth and humility and owning my personal abilities and the whole field of integration, just again, being so nascent. I fairly recently made a decision to actually not become licensed. So while I was in school, I was accepted provisionally to be on the therapist team for the Los Angeles site for the phase 3 MDMA-assisted psychotherapy trials. And I was the only one on the team that was not licensed. Now, even though everyone knew that I was not licensed, there wasn't a problem because I know that in Colorado there are quite a few others that are taken into the team as, you know, professionals in the field or whatnot. And what ended up happening was quite interesting because even though, again, I was supposed to start my doctorate this year to eventually become licensed, I immediately started experiencing a lot of pushback from others in the field that were licensed and who felt that it was inappropriate that I was on the team, and which it was obviously caused me to do a lot of thinking about, you know, who I am and what I can offer and what maybe what I cannot offer as well. And what are really going to be my main contributions to the field? Do I really want to be an academic? Do I want to be a teacher? Which I also wanted to be. I wanted to teach at university. Do I want to offer workshops, or do I really want to offer one-on-one integration? Like, what is it that I want to do? Do I want to write a book? So many things to offer. Do I want to be in the trials? So I really got into this just like self-exploration journey about my gifts. And the more that I started to do that, I also started working more with people. And from the feedback that I got from my clients, which, you know, clients and community are best teachers, I actually learned that there is perhaps more room even for those who are not clinicians in this field, because many people that do psychedelic work or entheogenic work, there is a part of them that is feeling a bit reserved still by approaching a licensed individual, because the professionals who are licensed have to abide by laws of ethics and conduct in their field, and they also have to abide they need to abide to diagnosis, right? And to me as a coach, this is not something that I have to do at all. On the contrary, I'm working as a paraprofessional, as a peer. So a lot of individuals that perhaps need the help don't approach therapists because they don't want to be diagnosed. Now, individuals who use psychedelics, you know, oftentimes, obviously, psychedelics can cause or are, in a way, by definition, they're a state of psychosis. And if they, you know, just so happen to turn to a clinician who is not well versed in with altered states of consciousness, they can easily be diagnosed as, you know, name at least 5 mental health disorders from the diagnostic statistics manual. I actually came to realize that for me, it actually seems better to not get licensed. And I recently made that decision to not be licensed and get my PhD, which is not clinical, and continue working again as a coach and as a peer, because I feel that people relate to me better in that way and they feel safer to really be open and authentic with everything that they're going through without fearing that, you know, anything that they say will backfire on them. And then that's just, again, what I'm finding from my experience that I've had so far working in this profession. And not to say that sometimes I'm not triggered. I do remember sitting at the conference and Rick Doblin in his opening speech was presenting his psychedelic psychotherapist ID that, you know, everyone hopefully will get one day in the future. And I was sitting there thinking, my goodness, am I making a huge mistake again by not deciding to not be licensed? But no, actually, again, the affirmations that I keep receiving, not just from, again, my clients, my surroundings, the universe, whoever it is, I know that for me, it's better to not become licensed. And I'm very happy to be able to serve people in that way. So there is room for everyone, you know, and if I do feel that, you know, if I do get clients that I feel definitely need or could use the help of a professional that can direct them with specific therapeutic interventions that I'm not able to offer, I refer them out. So it's all about also knowing where to, you know, what you are able to deal with and what you're not, and just really distinguish your services and just stick to that. So that's been really useful for me.
Mm. Awesome. Yeah. Thanks so much for sharing that. Cause we've definitely had some people reach out to us in the past asking like, how do I get involved in this? And yeah, it's always, I think it's such an individualized and personal choice. You know, I know I had that debate for like a few years when I was applying to grad school. I'm like, do I just want to get my master's and then in psychology, not do the clinical thing? And so I just want to do coaching. And yeah, it's a constant back and forth. And I think it's very personal and individualized on what you want to do.
Yeah. Right. And again, and the beautiful thing is that there is room for everyone. Mm-hmm. You know, there will be a million different types of coaches. Even if they all do the exact same thing, people gravitate towards different people. They gravitate towards different energies. So, you know, even clinicians and coaches can work together in many ways. So, you know, I think the what's really important to learn, and this is something that I learned actually just very recently, you know, with, and don't get me wrong, I'm super happy and proud of my, you know, the what accreditations I do have, which is, again, a master's in psychology, and I have a coaching certificate. And even though, you know, there are not too many of us doing integration right now, but I actually feel that only recently I really learned what integration was, and I learned it through my own experience. I, like, true integration, right? There were a couple of months very recently where I was doing a lot more medicine work than usual. It was the course of a very short time where I did, like, I think 8 ayahuasca ceremonies, experimented with LSD, MDMA, did a couple of rounds of combo frog and other shamanic medicines, and just all these things were happening at once, and I just felt this huge opening and my growth and the lessons that I've been receiving, to a point that it was just really overwhelming. Really overwhelming that I couldn't even sit down and do my daily meditation because I felt so triggered by everything that was rising to the surface. So I decided to take a break from my daily integration practices. And what ended up happening was, for about a month, that I was again kind of shunning it off because I was, you know, I just, like, I couldn't take it. I just really wanted to shut the entire psychedelic field down and just so I can ground. And during this month that I couldn't, again, do my usual practices, I just started feeling the opposite thing happened. Very ungrounded, very disconnected. My relationships were starting to suffer. My relationship with my husband started to suffer. A lot of anger started coming up, you know, not really feeling focused in my work and the projects that I'm working on. And, you know, it took me a while to just, you know, force myself to, okay, just, like, slow down. You have to go back to basics, which is, again, the daily practices. This is my safe place that I always go back to amidst the madness that is happening, right? The madness, which is all the lessons, the demands, our daily life, which can get so crazy. So I always go back to basics. And only once I started doing that and I started to feel like myself again, I really learned that that's what integration is, that, you know, if you're not taking the time and investing the time in yourself to remember who you are and remember why you're here and connect to your personal God, your higher self, and your purpose and your relationships, again, all about relationships, then there's really nothing left, you know? So that's when I really just learned what integration was. When I stopped integrating, that's when I learned what integration was.
Right.
Yeah.
I always kind of come back to that chop wood, carry water. You know, we could sometimes continue to do these spiritual practices, and, you know, maybe that's what integration is. But yeah, for me lately, it's just like chop wood, carry water. Like, how do you just go about and just live life after a really transformative experience without staying out in the ether and the clouds?
Right. So one of the main techniques that I utilize for integration is what I call the daily anchor methods. So basically, for me, I really try to practice self-care every day. In the morning, I'm a morning person, so I like to kind of set my stage in the morning first thing, otherwise I never get to it. So I wake up early, and then I have a list of various practices that I can do. And then I can choose from these practices to kind of cater my own personal menu of methods that will ground me and set me for the day. So these methods include, for example, meditation, journaling, reading a few pages in one of my millions of psychedelic books that I haven't yet to read yet, playing my guitar, connecting with a friend, going outside for a walk in the park near my house, or going to a dance class or something like that, yoga, maybe some artwork, praying, intention setting for the day. So just choosing a few of these practices and really sticking to them and knowing that this is what I do first thing in the morning, no matter what, like before I open Facebook, before I open the emails, before I jump into the text and the million other things that are just don't end. Before you get pulled down, you really pull yourself up and just again, ground down to, like you said, chop wood, carry water. Just remember who I am, why I'm here, this is what I need to do, and take it from there. So the daily anchor methods is one of the techniques that I really stress with my clients. You know, ultimately it's all about doing what you can sustain it's all about sustainability. So practices that are sustainable and for the long term.
What do you think the minimum viable practice is for like meditation or journaling? Say somebody can't, like they feel a block when they say, okay, I would love to write 3 full pages out this morning. Like, is a half a page like a good start? And like, you know, just see what works for them at the time, or how do you model that?
I would say it doesn't even have to make any sense. Mm-hmm. I call it a paper purge. So paper purge, whatever needs to come out, it doesn't have to be linear. It doesn't have to make sense. It doesn't even have to be complete sentences. It can be free association. Just whatever thought that comes to mind, you just purge it on the paper. It's amazing what this technique does, because again, a lot of the processing comes when we just are able to take all these experiences that we have stored in our body and in our mind and take them out into the physical world, if that makes sense. So all these ruminating thoughts and feelings that don't necessarily make sense, as soon as they're out of our minds, out of our bodies, and into something that you can hold in your hand, they have turned to have a life of their own that is outside of your body. And it just takes a lot of the load off. So I wouldn't even say it has to be any length of anything, just as long as it comes out in one way or another.
I've personally found a lot of value in journaling. I've been trying to follow that model of like morning pages. What was her name? Cameron, maybe. The Artist's Way. It's kind of a really fascinating book. And like, artists have a lot of the same problems that psychedelic folk do. So,
I like to have a book that's, I have a couple of 3 or 4 journals. One of them is dedicated just to journeys, where I, you know, write the what we call the cosmic log, everything that happened, that color, that shape, that being, that, you know. So yeah, and then I went, you know, then I purged, then I did this, and so I have a book like that, and I mark, you know, all the ceremonies I've had. I like to do that because it really tells the story of my growth. So a journal, even if you're not necessarily a writer, you don't have to be a writer to express your thoughts and your inner world.
My morning pages are chaos. There's no I don't even know that I could read it if I tried. But yeah, it's you know, anything, right? Like in breath work, we do art, and then we physically share. I think breath work could benefit from some sort of sustained integration practice. Maybe that's like the only thing it's really missing, but how can we do that other than following up with folks one-on-one or webinars or something, or just having them come back to more and more workshops, which might not be viable. So,
well, one way to, what, I mean, if you're, was that a question that you want an answer on, or
feel free.
Okay. Well, again, and you know, if an integration is all about taking those insights that you've learned in altered states and really living them through meditation and breath work while you're breathing, if you want to go back in while you're sitting at home, go back in your mind to the places that you visited while you were in breath work. I mean, if anything, I would find that to be an activating practice that can take you back to that experience too, and then you can relive it. Or if you want to continue working on it, if there's anything that was left unresolved, or if you want to find out what else is behind that. So that's one way to integrate, really, is to do a mini meditation/breathwork session at home.
How do you have people do the breath work at home? Like 10, 20, 30 minutes of accelerated breathing, or?
Well, you're the breathwork professional, aren't you?
But I only ever advise one format, which is funny. I always think about that. I'm like, you know, should I do more short form? Should I give people take home pranayama practices? But I'm just like, here's my expertise, and it's just these workshops, and you know, giving you a list of take home things that you might check out later on your own.
I have a list of YouTube meditations that I keep, and some of them involve breath work. Uh-huh. And if individuals want to start with breath work, I give them one of these links, and then they can meditate / breath work on that. Yeah, so that's, you know, a simple thing that I do. Just, you know, offer people resources to obviously to different sites, different, and you know, websites of information, communities in their area. I help them research practice integration practices or supportive practices that can be good for integration in their area. You know, essentially, is even if they're not called integration, as long as it's something that makes you feel good and helps you connect with yourself, and to your body, to your soul, to, and helps ground and center you, it's completely an integration practice. Mm-hmm. Petting your dog is an integration practice, you know?
Right.
So,
Yeah, I guess I'll jump in and just add like how I do like my short form breath work. If like I'm feeling anxious or something's coming up, I'll usually just lay down on the floor and take a couple deep breaths and feel where that tension is in my body. And then I use my breath to like make it a little bit bigger and try and bring it to the surface and push it out. But, you know, I also have a lot of this experience, and it's interesting because I just did a research study for one of my research courses on breath work, and I created like a 10 to 15 minute video with music, and it was really interesting to, you know, send that out and give instructions, and then people being like, I don't know, I didn't like it, or I felt like really irritable. But for me, since I have that background, maybe I know how to work with that energy a little bit differently versus somebody that's completely new. It might be really uncomfortable. So it's always like tricky when I'm like, how would I like really kind of teach like this short form breath work that I know from using like that, bring it up and release it to somebody completely new. And maybe that's just like a slower meditation of like just not trying to do that, just using the breath to slow down.
Exactly. Just focusing. I mean, when I began meditating and started my spiritual practices, again, just out of the blue and trying to find very simple resources, YouTube was a huge help for me. Just even the matter of connecting to the breath and really noticing where it flows through your body is a type of breath work.
Mm-hmm.
Breath of fire is a type of breath work. Just accelerated breathing is a type of breath work, right? So I think if there's another thing that I really learned at the Holotropic Breath Workshop at that conference was that it really wasn't about the breathing technique at all. Like it was just amazing to see how deeply you could go, or I at least, like I went super deep without even utilizing any type of technique. It was all about the space that was created and the permission to let go.
Right.
It was incredible. It was the setting, it was the music, it was the people, it was the fact that there was, you know, I had a partner who was sitting with me and made sure that I'd be safe. So all about safety and permission. So, you know, so creating the atmosphere at home that where you will feel safe to be able to do your work.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Yeah, that's crucial.
Yeah.
Definitely. Yeah, the group process is really powerful in that format. Mm-hmm. So,
well, same with psychedelics, you know, the whole idea behind the setting, right? Set and setting. It always goes back to set and setting.
Yeah.
So the setting for the home, setting for integration. Make sure you have all your little gadgets, your books, your journals, your prayer beads, your singing bowls if you need them. You know, whatever makes you feel good. Again, a lot of times we, especially, I don't know how it is where you guys live, but in LA, which is such a crazy town on so many levels, it's easy to feel ungrounded and you know, finding community, making sure that you your home surroundings is feels like a place where you can find sanctuary, and we forget how important these things are, you know. Mm-hmm. So really just going back to what matters. Mm-hmm. Without, you know, trying to impress anyone, finding friends that you can confide in and that you can be fully authentic with. That's why I am so proud of the integration circles that we have here in LA. You know, in the beginning, when I did them as part of Inner Space Integration in the beginning, now I run them as part of my own brand, which is a psychedelic integration coach. But in the beginning, we really thought that we had a responsibility to bring a lot of content and talk about different aspects of psychedelia. And, you know, we talked and talked, and then ultimately, like, people just want to meet and talk. People just want to connect. Yeah. So I've restructured the groups to include basically a few grounding exercises and just leave a lot of time for personal connection. And because people just want to meet the others. By meeting the others, they're affirmed, they feel safe, they feel heard, they know that they're not alone. And again, it's all about relationships. And that's, again, going back to integrate. I think it was Daniel McQueen, actually, that you had him as a guest. He said a sentence during his interview, which I thought was brilliant. Community is the best form of integration.
It is. Yeah.
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 I was going back to just immediately going to say that too. You beat me to it.
Yeah,
it's like, yeah, he's a brilliant thinker for sure.
Mm-hmm. And
it's really cool what he's done in Boulder.
Yes, and you know, if psychedelics, again, it's all about a return to wholeness. We, you know, our spirits, you know, whether we believe in spirits or not. Those who believe in the idea of us being spiritual beings, which for me is something that I really really started following when I started working with the psychedelic substances, was that if we are spiritual beings and we all come from the same source, we will always yearn to return to that wholeness. So we will always want to connect. We will always try to connect with others. A person that lives in solitude is, you know, that's usually causes a lot of illness, you know. Mm. So just doing everything we can to create space for people to connect and come together.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. On the topic of relationships, I know you touched on before we started recording this topic of being in a visionary relationship. Can you speak to that a little bit and what that is?
Or Doc, some people call him, his students. He's my husband. He is a psychiatric pharmacist, is a professor, and he also is starting Teach Now courses about uses of various alternative medicines to his students. And anyhow, Benjamin also works in psychedelic research and has a heavy interest in psychedelic research. We met at Visionary Convergence, which was the psychedelic conference here in LA about a month ago, which, by the way, is an amazing place to be single, because when you think about it, if you really want to meet someone that has the same interest and passion and life purpose, someone at a conference like that is a great idea, a great way to connect. So Ben and I met at the conference and immediately knew that we wanted to be together. We complement one another in a very interesting way. So he's a scientist, obviously a very strong academic background, wants to dedicatedly in one way or another to education and psychoeducation. And with his interest in psychedelics, that's the lens he brings to our relationships, and I obviously bring the more humanistic lens. So we're kind of an interesting combination. I think, I don't know who it was, but someone once, and Ruff actually, that said, oh, you're like the Shulgins, because Sasha was a scientist and his wife an psychologist. So we thought that was kind of cool. So yeah, we're both, you know, with our different interests in the psychedelic world, and both knowing that we really want to contribute heavily to the field and do our part in kind of ushering in the new age of consciousness and awakening and want to make sure that we're in service to those who are using psychedelic substances. And you know, doing the work that we do, not just professionally but also personally, obviously we've both experimented in the past with various types of medicines. And, you know, doing our own personal and individual work and realizing more and more that, especially because we haven't been together for so long at all, we've only been together for not even 2 years, but doing the medicine work together has accelerated our connection and has deepened our connection in so many ways, because what the medicines do is they really strip away any remnants of identity, ego identity that we have cultivated over the years. So you're really left in a very raw and vulnerable state before your beloved. And, you know, I think both of us are lucky enough to have partners that we're both individually interested in personal growth and hold a lot of space for that in our lives. And, you know, also both have a background of psychology, as he's in psychiatry. So we're both understand the need for human development and hold a lot of a very strong space for that. So consciously, this is something that we're really trying to cultivate in our relationship, allowing one another the space to do their growth in the way that they need. We're also very different in the way that we handle medicines, different capabilities, different relationships with the substances. So really making sure that we're not necessarily, like in the beginning, we really try to do everything together. Or just like I would really try to, you know, keep up with him on his practices, and it wasn't necessarily right for me. So there was also a time where we had to make room for the idea that, yeah, we're two, as much as we love each other and we have this unity, this partnership between us, we're still two different people on two different journeys. Mm. So, yeah, just making room for that and allowing each other the space they need for their to just go at their own pace. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but it's just been a beautiful blessing in our lives. And again, just to share that same purpose of wanting to serve others and to heal. And we have a dream one day to open or be a part of a healing retreat center somewhere. Mm. Where we can both offer our gifts and hold space for healing for others who need it. And yeah, and again, we feel like we complement that each other in that way.
Mm. That's great. Do you have a lot of teachers or know a lot of people that are in these type of relationships? I know like our breathwork teachers, they seem to complement each other, and you know, they have that retreat center, and I've always looked up to them like, man, that's really awesome. They do like all their, like this work, this really deep work together, and they have really great partnership, and yeah, it's a really cool thing. But it probably also really difficult at times too, when you're going through these deep transformative experiences and needing to hold it for the other person. And
yeah, exactly. And you know, this is something that we've, you know, very recently experienced. We had a pretty challenging couple of weeks. Again, when I was kind of deepening my work and you know, felt like I was on the verge of a few breakthroughs, and so I didn't want to stop, and got to a point where, you know, he told me straight up, you know, I think you're doing way too much. It's taking over our lives. I'm starting to be affected by it, or home is starting to be affected by it. Maybe there's time for anyhow, there was a lot of resistance, lot of resistance to what I was going through, and I really appreciated him for that, you know, because again, I felt like I was kind of going full speed ahead, and it was really good to have him reflect to me things that I wasn't seeing, and yes, to remember that even though I am on my journey, I still have this precious, beautiful partnership that I do want to care for, and this is the main thing in my life. And with all due respect to the medicine world and, you know, the medicine spirits, which I highly respect and follow and adore and dedicate my life to, you know, I still want to remember what the most important thing in my life is, which is my love. Mm-hmm. My love to my husband. So I am lucky again to have him as a partner. He's very solid and is able to kind of ground me when I need it. So yeah, but it is definitely challenging sometimes. Yeah,
that's great. And I think Joe and I both had a chance to talk to him a little bit at the conference, and he seems like he's doing some really awesome things. It'd be fun to get him on the show sometime and talk to him.
Yes, yeah, he's special. And again, he's a nerdy scientist, so he has a lot to talk about in that sense.
Yeah.
And that's why another reason why I feel so lucky to be in relationship with him, because again, in our field, you can imagine I have so many clients that get in touch because they have questions about using substances while they're on psychiatric medication.
Mm.
Obviously, with all the research that's going on recently, you know, people are kind of opening their eyes and wanting to see how they can perhaps utilize psychedelics to deal with various mental health issues. So I get all these medical questions that, you know, either I'm unable to answer. Usually I'm unable to answer because I have a very basic, I have enough but basic knowledge of the way that the psychedelics work on our brain and on our body. But Ben specializes in that. So I have him as a sounding board, and he consults me. Mm. On the various cases that I have, and sometimes I just straight out refer my clients to him so he can provide for them a pharmaceutical consultation. So that's mm-hmm. another really awesome way that we join forces between us.
Awesome, it's so cool.
Yeah.
Do you ever get people in, like, have relationship advice with some of the integration? You know, I know some people might have a really powerful experience and they're like, oh God, I need to, like, leave a relationship. Maybe instead of sticking through some of that difficult emotions that arise during the ceremony or whatever they were doing.
Advice on relationships. Well, I'm going to try to generalize that. So people that come with cool. major life decisions that if they feel like they need to make really big life changes, the idea is, or at least what I really try to reflect to them, that yes, oftentimes, again, we just emerge from the psychedelic realm feeling like a new person, like we know everything we need to know, and that it's time to utilize the lessons. But for major life changes, it's always good to take a break for at least a couple of weeks and really let the idea percolate and see what comes to the surface. And the idea is that if it seems like a good idea right now, then it'll still be a really good idea in 2 weeks or a month. So no making any major life changes, no divorcing your husband, no leaving your job, no relocating to the jungle to follow the plants, even though it's very tempting. I feel called all the time. But really, again, grounding, tapping in, seeing what's behind this desire for, or a call for change, what is coming up. Perhaps the call for change is because, you know, it's actually where the resistance is. That's, you know, because we don't want to face what we need to face. So it could be completely a wrong decision. So taking time, letting it percolate, not even necessarily speaking with anyone, because oftentimes if we speak to individuals who perhaps are, again, not familiar with altered states and medicines, or, you know, have just their own agenda or bias around it, they can greatly affect us. Our neuroplasticity is extremely high in the couple of weeks that follow medicinal experiences, so we're highly, the ability to be highly affected is even higher by others' opinions. So really trying to keep things to yourself, doing the work around it, and inner work, or again consulting a professional if you feel like you need a sounding board that you can bounce ideas off of, but not jumping ship and changing your whole life around. No. Yeah.
Awesome. Thanks.
I'm curious what other projects you might have going on other than your psychedelic coaching. I think you mentioned
so many. Thank you. Yes. Thank you for asking. So many of them. So obviously I have my private business as a psychedelic integration coach. I recently decided to hand over inner space integration to my partner so I can focus more on this project. And I run, as I mentioned, psychedelic integration circles currently in Santa Monica twice a month. We have about between 10 to 20 people that show up every time, and it's just phenomenal. And just always so happy to see the quality of people that come in, the different voices, different ideas. We have people that represent all different types of demographics all across the board, which I love that. Different ages, different professions. And so that's a really cool meeting place where people also network. So it's almost like a mini conference in a way. I love holding that space. I also host an ayahuasca integration group where we specifically work with before and after ayahuasca ceremonies, which is kind of like a closed, similar to group therapy, but not really therapy because, again, I'm a coach. And that meets on a weekly basis. There's also another series that I call the Shamanic Practices series, where I bring in different speakers that talk about various shamanic medicines. So far we had someone who spoke about hapé, which is a shamanic snuff, which is for me an integrative practice. I use it every day in my meditation, and that takes me back to ceremony. I love using that. That goes about monthly, and then also other lessons that I teach. I also work with Being True to You as a senior coach, and I work with addiction recovery clients. I teach classes with them, and I do group coaching with them. Very soon I'll be starting to offer, through Being True to You, a weekly group coaching call on psychedelic integration. So it's a group that people can call in and listen and be a part of the group.
Cool.
Another amazing project that I'm super proud of and happy to announce is the Los Angeles Psychedelic Science Symposium, which is the next psychedelic conference taking place in Los Angeles in February 2018. And we started this concept and just the idea started bubbling only about a month ago, but it's totally happening. We already have a few awesome speakers on board. It's being backed by MAPS.
Cool.
As well. So I'm on the planning committee, and this is one of the first announcements that we're making about it, by the way. So please spread the word. And another project is that I'm starting to lead retreats to Peru, to a center called Niue Rau. Dr. Joe Tafur, who gave a talk actually at the conference, he is a family doctor who for a few years was one of the founders and the clinical director of Niue Rau Center, which is an ayahuasca retreat center in Iquitos, near Iquitos in the jungle. And myself and my friend Glenice, who works at that center, we are taking a group to a retreat. But what's going to be different, there are many retreats going to Peru, obviously, but what we're trying to do differently is that we're actually offering, as part of the retreat, preparation and integration.
Great
sessions. So
smart.
Yes. So yeah, you know, the whole idea behind, I almost feel like we barely talked about integration, but the whole idea about integration is really being mindful to what happens before the experience and what happens after the experience. So if it's about creating the psychedelic experience from scratch. So the preparation phase, the session, and the integration phase. And for individuals who use psychedelics on a regular basis, you know, there's the integration and the preparation become one stage too. So we're constantly integrating. So yeah, the ayahuasca will get the preparation integration that it deserves, because we don't talk about that enough.
Right.
Without the integration, all these experiences just remain recreational experiences. The integration is where the work is. So I'm really trying to just like be of service to that and remind people that the work is done after the ceremony ends.
Sounds like you're up to a lot of different wonderful things. It's awesome. And where could people find out about that symposia that you guys are going to be hosting in Los Angeles?
We do not have a website yet. We will have a website very soon. Individuals who want to find out more information right now can contact either myself, of course, or Dr. Brad Adams, which is another incredible person that also gave a talk at the conference. And by the way, Brad has an organization here in Los Angeles called LAMPS, Los Angeles Medicinal Plant Society. And it's a group that meets every month and hosts speakers mainly about the academic, not only, but mainly about the academic side of psychedelics, just bringing in different people from the field to network. So people can also contact LAMPS to find out more about the conference. But we will have a website very soon.
Cool. Any way people could reach out to you or find your website?
Sure. It's www.psychedelicintegrationcoach.com. I'm also on Facebook, the Psychedelic Integration Coach, trying to find my way through the Instagram world. Social media or my website. I'm currently in the process of also looking for individuals who want to learn more about integration. I'm hoping to expand my practice. I'm getting a lot of requests, a lot more than I think I can handle on my own. And I would love to get new people under my wing so I can train them and have them work with individuals who need integration work. So if any of you out there listening and are interested in learning more about integration, lending yourself to a great cause, please reach out or just to say hi to. I love meeting new people and just fascinated by the beautiful, beautiful intentions of our community and to you guys as well for doing the important work that you're doing. Again, there's room for everyone. There's room for every voice out there. We each have something to say, and we're each a different expression of consciousness. And together, we're really painting this beautiful, beautiful canvas that, you know, hopefully in 10 or 20 years, when all of these substances are legal, as they should be, we will be able to look back at this time and really see how we each contributed to this amazing field and do it with pride, because we're awesome.
It's a cool time to be part of all of this, for sure.
Yeah, we are lucky and blessed.
Awesome. Well, I think we're probably definitely over an hour at this point. Thanks for coming on the show. It was great chatting with you, and hoping, you know, we'll have you back on to see what you're up to in the future. And yeah, thanks so much for chatting with us.
Thank you for having me, you guys. All the best to you, and yeah, see you at the next conference.
Yeah.